थैंक यू सर, थैंक यू वेरी मच सर,
थैंक यू सर।
डॉक्टर पिंजल रामकृष्ण लॉग्ड इन?
यस आई एम हियर। डॉक्टर फायज इज गोइंग टू प्रेजेंट फर्स्ट एंड देन आई विल प्रेजेंट।
Pinjal, this is wherein you are one of the examiners, and Dr. Krishnamaraju and Dr. K. Abraham are going to be the examiners. Okay? And then the format is, let the candidate finish the history presentation, followed by consultants and the faculty will examine the candidate sequentially. Simultaneously. So starting with you or ending with you. We'll start with the Krishnamaraju, then followed by Dr. K. Abraham, followed by you, and followed by Dr. Satyamurthy.
Okay.
Okay. Can you ask your resident to present the case?
Yes, sure. Just a second. Yes. Has he checked in? Let me find out.
Yes, yes sir. I'm...
Dr. Fayaz, can you do the slide sharing?
Good afternoon, sir. Yes, sir. Sure, sir. Is it visible, sir?
Yeah, we can see you.
Dr. Krishnamaraj Garu?
You have to go to the slideshow mode.
Yes, sir.
That's right. Very good.
Shall I start, sir?
Yeah, please. Can we start?
Yeah, please do.
Okay, thank you. Let's start.
Good afternoon, all. I'm Dr. Fayaz, vascular surgery resident and exam assistant of medical sciences. I would like to present the case of abdominal aortic aneurysm.
Your microphone is not close to you. Keep the microphone close to you.
Okay, sir. I would like to present abdominal aortic aneurysm with right common iliac artery aneurysm.
Still, it is not clear. It is not clear. Voice is not clear. Maybe connectivity. Connect the microphone properly.
Just a moment, sir. Just a moment.
Yeah, it is audible now.
Now it is good.
Yeah. Okay. Sixty-five-year-old gentleman who is a known hypertensive and diabetic for past 15 years. Presented with complaints of blackish discoloration of right third and fourth toes since 5 months. He also gives complaint of abdominal fullness and pain in upper abdomen radiating to back since 3 months. He was a chronic smoker but stopped after he was diagnosed with coronary artery disease 2 years back. No history of any claudication, no other comorbidities, no significant past history. On general physical examination, patient was moderately built and moderately nourished. His BP was 160 upon 110 mm of Hg. Pulse rate was 98 beats per minute. It was regular and rhythmic. Respiratory system and cardiovascular system were essentially normal. Abdominal examination revealed mass of 10 to 12 centimeters in epigastrium and left hypochondrial region extending up to the umbilical region. Mass was pulsatile, foaming consistency, mild tenderness. All peripheral pulses were palpable on peripheral vascular examination. Ischemia of third and fourth toes of right foot was seen. All routine investigation and thorough workup was done. And we planned for CT angiogram. CT angiogram revealed infrarenal abdominal aortic aneurysm. Right common artery aneurysm, as shown in the picture.
After the angiogram, you can stop for the questioning. Okay. You can describe the angiogram.
The angiogram revealed the infrarenal abdominal aortic aneurysm with calcification of the abdominal aortic wall and right common iliac aneurysm. It is extending into the part of internal iliac. And you can see the collateral circulation.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. Then shall we proceed, sir?
The next picture is also angiogram.
No, sir. It's about the surgery, what we plan.
Okay, Dr. Krishna Raj Garu, would you like to ask him questions now? Hello? Raju Garu.
Krishna Raju? Abraham? Hey, Abraham.
Okay. Let me ask you the question. When you are taking history of a patient like this, what are the points that you would like to ask the patient in relation to the aneurysm?
The associated risk factor we have to evaluate, sir, like history of hypertension, history of smoking, and any history of trauma.
Yes, okay, good.
At the same time, we have to rule out any about discal circulation, like we have to any claudication, history of claudication pain or distal gangrene. But these aneurysms are associated with thrombosis, which leads to distal embolization and lead to gangrene of the
leg. Very good. Yes.
Yes, sir.
Why do you want to ask about hypertension?
Hypertension is the associated risk factor, which is one of the most common risk factor associated with aneurysm. So, and it is the underlying pathology of the most of the aneurysms are, these are the degenerative aneurysms, and the underlying pathology will be the atherosclerotic disease. One of the major risk factors for the atherosclerotic disease is the hypertension. So we have to rule out the hypertension as a cause. And second thing is, sometimes these things, distal embolization of renal artery, and these will lead to hypertension also. And the disease per se also lead to hypertension again.
Is there any relationship with the antihypertensives that the patient is using and the aneurysm? Is there any antihypertensive agent that is associated with aneurysms in reduced incidence or increased incidence?
Beta blocker usually associated with the studies reveal that the beta blocker usually associate low incidence of abdominal aorticum, and the growth of the aneurysm growth also be in, bit reduced.
All beta blockers have that protective effect, or propranolol only has got that protective effect?
Propranolol, sir. Centrally acting beta blocker specifically have that effect, sir.
What about losartan?
Losartan to have the effect of
reduced expansion of the aneurysm.
Yes, sir.
What about amlodipine? Is the risk is increased or decreased by amlodipine?
Not pretty sure about it, sir.
I think amlodipine slightly increases the risk of expansion of the aneurysm.
Yes,
what about doxycycline?
It associated with reduced risk, sir. It decreases the size, reduce the risk of the aneurysm.
The rapidity at which the expansion takes place is reduced.
Yes, sir.
Very good. So how do you correlate with the life expectancy of these patients and the type of treatment that you would like to plan? Life expectancy of these patients and the type of treatment you would like to plan, based upon the life expectancy.
If the patient life expectancy is more than 5 years, the most durable procedure like open aneurysmal repair should be offered to the patient. Why? Because it's more durable. Whereas the endovascular procedure, though they are associated with less morbidity and mortality, in long term they are associated with so many adverse.
Very good. What rate do you think the aneurysm expansion will indicate you to do an operation? Rate of expansion?
One centimeter per year, sir.
5 millimeters.
Yes,
if there is a between two CT scans within a year, if you have seen there is an increase of more than half centimeter, you should keep it in mind it is expanding.
Yes, sir.
So I give it to the next examiner. Do we have the next examiner available? Hello, Dr. Krishna Raj Garu.
Hello. And, Sir Satyamurthy is there?
Sir.
Huh?
I
think there is some problem in communications here.
Okay, Dr. Fayaz, is there any relationship between diabetes and aneurysms?
Diabetes is protective for aneurysms, sir. And even the drugs which used for diabetes like metformin, any of studies shows that it is a protective for aneurysm, especially abdominal aortic aneurysm.
I think your microphone is going forward and backward.
You can wait. So why not disconnect the microphone completely and directly talk through the phone? That might be consistent, even if low.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. So diabetes is protective for abdominal aortic aneurysm, sir. And even the drugs which we use for diabetes, like metformin, also shown to be good. I mean, protective.
Protective. Any racial differences between the aneurysms?
Yes, sir. It is more common in Caucasians compared to our Asian population. Even though the same disease, atherosclerosis, is the culprit, but the Caucasians have higher chances of developing aneurysm.
At what time would you like to consider operations or interventions for aneurysms? At what size and why?
Ideally, it is more than 5.5 centimeters. In abdominal aortic aneurysm. Why? Because the rate of rupture will be increases enhanced after the 5.5 centimeters. The studies like UK small aneurysm trial showed that the size more than 5.5 centimeters tend to be ruptured more rather than the less than 5.5 centimeters.
Okay. So what are the identification marks in the CT scanning that this case is suitable for endo repair, this case is not suitable for endo repair?
To have an endo repair, the anatomy should be anatomy.
Your microphone is still not working well. It's going, coming and going.
Please talk directly through the phone. Do not use the microphone.
Yes, sir. I'm directly using it. Is it audible now?
You are moving forward and backward when you are talking. That's why it is not capturing properly.
Okay.
Keep the phone close to your mouth.
Okay.
Dr. Jain is there? RK?
Yes. RK, I thought that's me. Okay, go on. What are the indications for endo repair?
Endo repair planning, the anatomy is one of the most vital things. The neck should be less than 3 mm in length. Should be more than 3, at least more than 3 mm. And less than 1.5 mm. The diameter should be less than 2 mm. Neck should, hello?
Go ahead, your voice is heard in between.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Nitin Kabra is there? Nitin?
I'm here, sir.
Yeah. Your participation is required, sir.
Okay, sir. Definitely. Because you didn't tell me I didn't participate, sir.
No. Your participation is required.
I think as you have been asking him, sir, about losartan and all you have described, and you asked him about the risk factors for aneurysm also. Okay, and the final question which you asked is about the suitability for endovascular repair and this way. Okay, I think Dr. Fayaz, the most important thing when you look at the CT picture here. Okay, what is that which comes to your mind here? What types of abdominal aortic aneurysms, how do you divide them into basic two large groups, is it not?
Yes, sir. Saccular and fusiform.
No, that is on the shape. Okay, the most important thing is whether it is infrarenal.
Yes.
Okay, or suprarenal also. That is what we have to decide. Okay.
Yes,
whether these aneurysms belong to a part of a, like sometimes you can have Takayasu arthritis. Okay, is it involved in the abdominal aorta? So are these aneurysms a part of Takayasu arthritis? So where you have stenosis, aneurysm, stenosis and aneurysm and all. Okay. But here I think it looks like more of a saccular aneurysm. And maybe I think there's some thrombus involvement there definitely, which we can see. There's some calcification in the wall of the abdominal aorta. Okay, and this is like a inverted Y, you can say. Okay, it's involving both common iliac arteries and all. If you say the common iliac arteries are not normal, okay, but it's much below the superior epigastric artery also, and it's much below the renal arteries. Okay, so does it help you in planning your strategies for management and all?
Yes, sir. For endovascular repair, we have to look for the neck and distal landing zones. In this case, probably the neck is length of the neck, and we should see for the length and the diameter of the neck. Length should be
the length seems to be 3 centimeters or so, isn't it?
Yes,
length is definitely more than 2 centimeters.
Length you are able to say, I think you can, as Dr. Ramakrishna has pointed out, I think you can make a rough estimate of the length here. Even if you do not have the quantitative, they have not measured the etiology in that particular film, I think a rough estimate can definitely be made out.
Yes, sir.
Correct.
And the other issue is the thrombus in the neck and the calcification in the neck, and the diameter seems to be okay in this case.
Yeah.
So these are the other parameters which have to look for the neck, sir, proximal zone. And in the distal zone, we have to look for the distal landing zone where the normal vessels are like. In this case,
what about the right common iliac artery and external iliac artery junctional aneurysm?
Yes, sir. It is involving right common iliac and even external iliac, part of internal iliac also, sir. So in this case, the distal landing zone will be should be in the external iliac. In that case, we'll have a problem of closing one of the, we need to close one of the internal iliac artery.
Okay.
And before closing it, we should be pretty sure about other internal iliac artery and pelvic circulation before planning in that scenario. And
suppose if you by mistake you close both internal iliacs, what will happen?
It may lead to pelvic ischemia, colonic ischemia, and gluteal claudication, depending on.
Yes. Yes. You are right. Very good.
Dr. Fayaz, would you like to talk about the surgical aspects on this case and all?
Okay. Can we ask him to show the next few slides of surgery?
Yeah, please, sir.
Okay, go ahead. Show the next few slides, Dr. Fayaz.
Yes, sir. This case, we planned electively. We planned for abdominal aortic aneurysm repair. Thorough workup was done. PAC was done. And under general anesthesia, midline laparotomy.
Did you happen to do coronary angiogram prior to surgery in this case?
Yes, sir.
Why do you want to do coronary angiogram before surgery?
We want to rule out the we will do a risk stratification. If you have we'll rule out the coronary artery disease.
Okay, you have done coronary angiogram, then they have identified asymptomatic coronary artery lesions. Now, what is your strategy?
There are two schools of thought, sir. Some people advise to go ahead for coronary stenting, but newer guidelines suggest only should address the primary the pathology first if it is asymptomatic.
Suppose if you do coronary intervention, what is the problem?
If we go for a coronary intervention, the patient may need dual antiplatelets. If he underwent PTCA, he needs dual antiplatelets, which will hinder our surgical procedure.
So there is no protection or increased risk after coronary intervention if you are going to do aneurysm repair.
You are
in the good interest of the patients, you are considering coronary angioplasty before AAA repair. Will it be of help to the patient, or sometimes it can be harmful to the patient?
Sometimes it can be harmful, sir.
So the NEJM articles say that there is some associated risks. By doing interventions, of course, if the patient is symptomatic, significant lesions, AAA left main, then you have to consider intervention. But otherwise, small vessel lesions, maybe you can manage asymptomatic patients with conservative line of management. Go ahead with AAA. What is the expected mortality for AAA? Expected mortality rates and acceptable mortality.
5 to 10%. It is
Below 3%. It should be preferably below 3% when you are planning operations. You should consider and focus, your mortality should be less than 3%. Very good. Okay, now you explain the operation.
Ramakrishna is right when he's saying that this one and all. Okay, by doing a coronary angiogram, probably I think we may find some stenosis and all. At his age, it's likely to have some coronary artery stenosis, okay, which you can make out on the angiogram. But is that coronary artery stenosis producing myocardial ischemia? And if it's producing myocardial ischemia, is it a significant amount of myocardium in geopardy? Okay, so based on the geopardy score and based on this, probably I think you will be entitled whether to go for an AAA repair first or whether to go for a PTCA stenting for the coronary artery first. Okay, because what happens if you do a PTCA stenting, and nowadays with the drug-eluting stenting and all, most of the time you'll be requiring some DPT for minimum 6 months duration. Okay, if it's a bare metal, probably you can stop it after 1 month, and if it's an emergency surgery. But suppose he has a problem, because the patient primary problem has been an abdominal aortic aneurysm, he has come because of that and all. Okay, and sometimes by doing a coronary angiography, which may be a class 1 indication here as per the guidelines, but we land sometimes more in the problem. And by revascularizing a lesion without knowing whether it's physiologically significant, okay, a lesion on coronary angiography is an anatomical finding, okay, but the physiological correlate of that, the physiological consequence of that is the myocardial ischemia. And the myocardial ischemia, how much is the territory involved? Okay, but the large territory is like Dr. Ramakrishna told you, the LMC involvement, significant proximal triple vessel disease involvement with LV dysfunction. Probably by doing a PCI, you are going to help the patient. But this type of involvement, these are not involved. A distal disease, a two vessel disease, single vessel disease without LV dysfunction, no LMC involvement. Okay, by doing a stenting, probably you are going to delay this surgery more. Okay, and as, God forbid, if the patient requires some rapid expansion or yes, a minor leak from that. Okay, so you are between the devil and the deep sea. Okay, because DAPT, if you stop, the chances of cervical thrombosis are there. And if you leave this leak, okay, patient is going to have a short mortality. Okay, so this is always like keep the patient interest first and always think in the proper perspective, I think. So that's most important thing to know here. So now please go ahead there.
Go ahead.
Surgery. Patient under general anesthesia. So point position, midline laparotomy incision is given. And subcutaneous incision incised and abdominal wall is opened. And we expose the abdominal aorta. The picture what we are seeing is the after exposing the abdominal aorta, it shows the infrarenal abdominal aneurysm and right iliac aneurysm, common iliac aneurysm.
So with can you use the pointer and show what is that what you are showing? Pointer is there in your company. Yeah. Now describe what is what.
This is the infrarenal abdominal aortic aneurysm. Probably this is the bifurcation, this part, and this is the iliac part, common iliac aneurysm.
Okay. Right common iliac artery aneurysm, what the forceps is showing, yes.
So we did a meticulous dissection, we took a control of the proximal infrarenal abdominal aorta and distal iliac control has been taken and the vascular clamps were applied. This picture shows the iliac aneurysm more precisely, more clearly, and then under all control we open the aneurysmal sac. Thrombus was evacuated. There was a huge thrombus load was there, and the thrombus was evacuated. And we completely opened the aneurysmal sac. Then we planned the repair of the abdominal aortic aneurysm with the synthetic graft, Dacron graft, which is 16:8.
This is the synthetic. Now, can you show us the sac? Can you show us the sac 1 second, sir? So, what is that we are concerned about sac? When you are opening the sac like this, what type of bleeding you are worried? You are sometimes worried about bleeding, back bleeding from the lumbar arteries.
Yes, sir. Most of the time, the lumbar arteries, there are so many lumbar arteries will be there. The back bleeding is the worrisome most of the time. So in this case, those are ligated. Actually, when lumbar arteries are there, it is advisable to ligate it, suture it with the persisting suture with the Proli, 6-0 Proli. In this case, we ligated, sir. There is no bleeding.
What is the relevance of the lumbar arteries with the endo repair?
During endo repair, what
is the relevance of lumbar arteries?
These are the culprits for type 2 endo leak, sir.
Very good. Type 2 endo leak. Excellent. So that is the reason what you should keep in mind, lumbar arteries. And during surgery, you can directly open and then close them. But in endo repair, you generally don't close them. You may relatively wait for 6 months' time so that they may subside on their own. If they don't subside, then you have to reconsider some interventions, endovascular interventions. So how many lumbar arteries will be there? 1, 2, 3, 4 pairs. Okay, good, good.
And Dr. Fayaz, like if you check the CT, the wall was calcified, aortic wall and all.
Yes.
So when the table, we do expect the aortic wall to be friable, okay, this type of a picture and all. So how was the aortic wall here, all of the aneurysm and this way?
The middle
of... Hello. Hello.
Sir, namaskar vandi.
How are you?
In Dr. Nagesh, andi. Hope you remember me.
Sure, sir. Chappan.
Hello.
Can we... Can we mute? Sir, the private talk is going on. Can we mute it, please?
Fayaz, you can answer that question.
Yes.
Healthy part, the anastomo is the proximal, the graft with the healthy part of the abdominal aortica, abdominal aorta. The sac was calcified, sir. But
was the part friable?
The almost one beneath the infrarenal, almost up to 1.5 centimeter, it was normal, sir. Beneath that, it was a calcified vessel.
Calcified? No, because if the wall is friable and all, the chances of successful rupture and this one at the time rupture may be more common, and that is
correct.
Precautions at that time.
So, if the wall is ruptured, what are your techniques of suturing? What type of technique? You use special plate jets.
We take a plate jets and...
Jet suturing, okay. Huh.
Special suturing techniques you follow. Very good. Or sometimes even use a Dacron strengthening of the wall. Outer side, you can keep a Dacron and then strengthen the wall. And the technique of suturing is different. You avert the graft and then suture it from inside and then flip it back onto the friable aorta technique. Okay, you tell us what are the parts that you are seeing here? What are the different, name them? Yeah.
Dr. Pinjara, can I ask a question here?
Please go ahead.
What is the risk of spinal cord injury in this type of surgery?
Excellent question. Dr. Fayaz, would you like to answer that? What are the chances of spinal cord injury?
The huge aneurysm which abuts the vertebral column sometimes, we know scalloping sign will see. Those are sometimes associated
with the particular, but
most of the time.
Not able to hear anything.
Hello, sir. Am I audible, sir?
Not audible at all.
In between, you are coming and going.
Okay, sir.
The question is, in thoracic aortic aneurysms, what is the incidence of spinal cord ischemia? What is the incidence of spinal cord ischemia in the infrarenal abdominal aortic aneurysms? And it is, if so, if there is a difference, then why is it so?
Yes, sir. In infrarenal abdominal aortic aneurysm, it's relatively rare compared to the thoracic abdominal aortic aneurysm, sir. Why? Because the area of the graft which we cover is the larger area we cover. And the usually sometimes it may occur the artery of Adam Quay.
At what level Adam Quay's artery is there?
Around T11, sir.
T10 to T11. Okay, good.
Yes. No, but my question to you is, can you predict it?
Yes. Can you predict the incidence of spinal cord ischemia? Because for that, you should know what are the blood vessels supplying the spinal cord.
Yes, sir. Sir, it is usually more associated with thoracic aneurysm, sir. In those procedures,
about a thoracic aortic aneurysm, I'm talking about abdominal aortic aneurysm. So, did you do any spinal cord decompression before you started the surgery?
No, sir. Usually in infrarenal, it is most of the time not required, but in thoracic, it is.
No, but are you trying to say that you don't consider this spinal cord decompression at all in abdominal aortic aneurysm? God forbid, if it is, let us say, if it is only 2% or 5%, then once you get it, you can't do anything about it. So, usually, at least in the interventional thing, we are supposed to do decompression of the spinal cord.
Yes.
To do elective lumbar puncture and then bring down the pressure? And do you monitor the spine?
No, sir. No, not.
It is not a routine practice to do it in the abdominal.
No. I agree. It's not a routine practice. But you're supposed to do what we call action potentials by remote stimulation.
Yeah, that is much more often considered in thoracic aneurysm when you are thinking coverage is more than 20 centimeters of the aorta coming from the descending thoracic aorta to the abdominal aorta, where there is a longer coverage and the arteries supplying the spinal cord will be affected.
No, but here, abdominal aortic aneurysm, some percentage will be there, no? But how do you predict it?
Yeah. How we predict is, suppose if the patient has got subclavian artery obstruction or stenosis, because vertebral artery is not perfused well, or if the patient has internal iliac arteries, both sides have gone, patient has got Adam Cue has occluded, the intercostal arteries are also affected. So in such patients, we will consider evaluation of the spinal cord ischemia in the perioperative period by monitoring or putting a spinal tap. But
or do you do any hypothermia to the spinal cord? Or
normally for infrared abdominal aorta, the clamping time is very short. We don't generally do all those special maneuvers. But we tend to implant internal iliac, at least one internal iliac intact. See that circulation is going to the internal iliac, because part of the circulation to the spinal cord comes from the internal iliac artery also.
Yeah. So I thought, abdominal aortic aneurysm infrarenal is far simpler than suprarenal.
Yes, absolutely.
Agreed. But I thought, these vascular surgeons and interventionalists do take enough of care in preventing spinal cord damage.
Usually, it is not in the routine list unless there is a special concern for the patient.
Okay,
show us the graft where it is going with marks. Yeah, that is anastomosis.
Yes, this is anastomosis.
What type of graft is this?
The Dacron graft, sir.
Dacron graft, was it knitted or woven?
It's knitted graft, sir.
Very good. What is the difference between knitted and woven graft?
Woven grafts usually require pre-clotting. There are more porous compared to the knitted one.
Knitted is more porous.
Yes, sir.
Woven is less porous. Okay, good. What is this dark black line on the graft?
This helps in orientation of the graft, sir, actually.
Very good. So that there is no twist. Twist or turn.
Yes, sir.
Very good. Go ahead. Come on, explain the operation a little more.
Yes, sir. We did a proximal anastomosis with the healthy part of the aorta. We anastomosis with the proline suture here. And this is the bifurcated graft. And after proximal anastomosis, we enclose the aneurysmal sac over the
what happened to the inferior mesenteric artery?
Inferior mesenteric artery was occluded, sir. In this case, it is actually thrombosed and occluded.
Very good. So you don't have to re-implant because it is already occluded.
Yes, sir.
Intestinal circulation is maintained with the other system. Okay.
And we completely enclose the proximal part of the graft with the sac, so as to prevent the adhesion between the bowel and the graft. The pulsatile graft causes, if we won't do this step, the pulsatile graft causes the erosion in the bowel and adhesion of the bowel, and further leading to gastrointestinal fistula between the graft and bowel wall.
Okay. Next slide.
Distally, moving to the distal part, there is a right common iliac aneurysm extending into part of internal and external iliac. We took the control of the
Use the marker to show where is the aneurysm.
Yes, sir. This is right iliac aneurysm. External iliac artery and internal iliac artery control was taken. And the part of internal iliac and part of external iliac also is dilated.
Okay. We excise the whole part of the right common iliac aneurysm, and we ligated the internal iliac artery.
Okay.
Ensuring the other side internal iliac artery is patent, and we ligated this internal iliac artery. Then the right part of the graft, the distal part of the right part of the graft is anastomosed to external iliac artery. So right side we did the anastomosis of the distal part of the graft to the external iliac artery, whereas in left side we did with the common iliac artery. Here we open the sac here. So this is the anastomosis. This is the final picture. This is left side, and this graph showing right side, which is anastomosed to external iliac artery, whereas left side we anastomosed to common iliac artery. And thorough hemostasis was achieved. This is the final picture. This is the left limb of the graft, which is anastomosed to left common iliac artery. Here the right limb, which was anastomosed to right external iliac artery. This is the sac. We close the sac and retroperitoneum. We close the retroperitoneum. Thorough hemostasis was achieved, and we closed abdomen in the layer.
Very good. What are the structures you are concerned at the common iliac artery? During surgery, what structures you are concerned?
The major concern is the veins, sir. Veins are very friable. If they tend to, tear with the traction and all, and they cause torrential bleeding. One thing. And the second thing is the nerve plexus.
Okay.
That's why we try to dissect the aorta towards the left side.
Okay.
Otherwise, so some people do elective stenting for the ureter to avoid the injuries.
Yes.
Usually we can identify the ureter and we can safeguard it during the procedure.
Very good, very good. Ureter should be protected, looked for, protected, and all measures should be taken that there is no injury to the ureter, because if you don't detect injury to the ureter, you may have post-operative complications. Okay, next.
So the intra-op and the post-op was uneventful, and we discharged the patient on 6th POD. He came back to us after 2 weeks. This is the follow-up, the picture. He came by walking. He was absolutely fine. He's in regular follow-up.
So what are the known complications after abdominal aortic aneurysm surgery?
You can divide the complication into intra-op complication, immediate post-op complication, and late complication. Intra-op complications are like the bleeding, and perioperative morbidity such as perioperative MI, mortality such as M, there are chances of MI and during clamping specifically. And immediate post-op, bleeding, infection, and distal ischemia, and distal ischemia, limb loss sometimes, and another devastating complication like renal failure. From emboli will go into the renal arteries and lead to renal failure.
Will the post-operative creatinine go up sometimes?
Yes, sir. Sometimes it will go up. The chances may be small embolization from the aneurysm.
Renal arteries.
It's a partial clamping. Sometimes, though we do infrarenal clamping, for a partial time we do clamp superiorly. For a few seconds we do suprarenal clamps also. Sometimes we require. Those things may be to renal damage.
Dr. Nitin, please ask him.
Yeah, Dr. Ramakrishna, 50% of the things we are not able to hear his voice. And
I know. I tried my best to tell him to speak close to the phone. He's going forward and backward.
Oscillation of his
ear. What is happening with your phone, Dr. Fayaz? We are getting the disturbance with your phone. Okay, no problem.
Yeah.
You try your best.
Yeah. What is the advice you give him now, once he's discharged? And I hope you are able to hear me.
Dr. Fayaz? Can you hear us?
Sir.
Are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I want to know once the patient is discharged, okay, what advice will you give him? Okay, and then what follow-up protocol he has to follow, and what further risk factor management or investigations for coronary artery disease, other vascular beds.
Sir, usually we give antiplatelet drugs and the statin group of drugs.
Antiplatelet, no, like more specific little and all. Which antiplatelet, single, dual, okay, aspirin, clopidogrel, or are there any trials with that?
Usually we give aspirin. Am I audible, sir?
Yeah, audible, but you are moving. Don't move.
Yes, sir.
Don't move.
Yes, sir.
Now tell.
Usually we give single antiplatelet drug like aspirin and a statin group of drugs.
How much aspirin?
Aspirin 75 mg, sir.
75 OD, okay.
Yes, sir. And the initial days we give atorvastatin maximum dose like 80 mg. After that, we will taper it to 40 mg.
Mm-hmm. Like how is atorvastatin going to help him?
The underlying cause is atherosclerotic disease. So the statin will stabilize and
plaque stabilization. Okay.
Yeah. So because it's more of you're thinking of an atherosclerotic aneurysm and all. Yes. Atherosclerotic aneurysm of the aorta. Does it have predilection for a particular part of the aorta or something like that? Or how do you differentiate on atherosclerotic and non-atherosclerotic aneurysm from
The atherosclerotic aneurysms usually associate with the other part aneurysms of other part of the body, such as popliteal artery aneurysm and femoral artery aneurysms.
No, like, does it have a predilection for a particular part of the aorta, atherosclerosis?
Yes, it is usually associated with infrarenal abdominal aortic aneurysm.
Shear stress, is there anything to do with the shear stress? Yeah.
Yes, sir.
And also the elastin content of the infrarenal aorta is less and then more easily damaged.
Yes.
Compared to the thoracic aorta. Thoracic aorta is very rich with elastic coil, elastic membrane, elastic fibers. The average life of elastic fibers is 40 years. As the age advances, the number of elastic fibers degenerate.
Yes, sir.
By the action of the MMP2 elastase. So that is lost in the infrarenal segment of the aorta. So that is why it is more prone for aneurysms.
What was the damage? So one is aspirin, second is statin. What about other things?
Blood pressure tablets, you'll continue. Not able to hear you. No. Microphone.
Will advise
anti-hypertensive
medication.
All right.
Okay, I think that's some problem.
Yeah, he has got some problem. We have put up with this problem for almost half an hour.
Yeah, because of the internet and all this, the technology is going to create a problem anywhere, I think.
Well, the problem here is, I think he's using a phone or is he using a laptop or what is the...
I should have asked him beforehand what he has got.
Laptop only,
but the microphone I think is not picking up properly.
He should have put
something like this. He should have kept.
Then it would not have made. Pinjala, would you like to say something about the natural history of these synthetic tubes?
Yeah, definitely. The tubes were used from the Second World War times. See, I was told that in London they used to stitch the nurse used to stitch the graft, Teflon graft, nylon grafts and other things when the doctors are operating on the patients who came from the World War. And that was the reason. Before that, they were using glass tubes. Glass tubes were used for replacing Dubost. The French surgeons were using glass tubes. Then they came to the Dacron grafts, Teflon grafts, Dacron grafts, and so on, so on. And now we also have grafts known as polytetrafluoroethylene grafts. So for the endografts, I think the same material is used for the endovascular grafts. And the Dacron or the thin PTFE grafts are used along with the stents. But the first was done in France. The Dubost has done the first repair, successful repair. And in history, it would be interesting to know that Einstein, Albert Einstein, had aneurysm of the abdominal aorta. And at that time, the repairs were not so popular. So they used cellophane in him to wrap it, to wrap the aneurysm so that it won't expand and rupture. And it did work very well for 6 to 7 years period of time. And after 7 years, it started expanding once again. And when he went to the doctors, they said, we'll refix it. But Einstein said, I don't want refixing. One time repair is enough. So he refused the second operation. And then finally, I think it ruptured and he lost his life. Einstein, the famous E=mc², great man. So I think we have come through a long distance, a long passage of time for the grafts. You know, we were using knitted grafts. After came were the woven grafts. Knitted grafts will have high porosity. So before, by the porosity, the platelets get trapped into the porosity and they stop the bleeding. So that's why we have to do a procedure known as Sauvage technique of pre-clotting. The grafts are pre-clotted for 5 to 25 minutes with the unheparinized blood. That's why when we are clamping, we always take the blood and then put the graft into the unheparinized blood and let it curdle so that the porous nature of the graft is gone. So this is very important. Sometimes if we are not alert, you heparinize the patient and you will find it difficult to pre-clot the graft. So that's why surgeons are always obsessive about taking unheparinized blood before clamping.
Ramakrishna, like, what is the natural history after the graft implantation? What this type of cases and all?
What is it?
Natural history of these people over a period of, say, next 10 years and all.
Survival. Excellent, excellent question, because nowadays we are all, as an interventionist, we are all interested in knowing what happens to the proximal neck, what happens to the distal neck. Because when we put a stent graft, we are putting from inside and hoping that the neck will not expand. They have taken long-term studies of 10 to 15 years of follow-up, and they found out that the necks do expand 0.5 to 6-7 millimeters in some patients, but in majority of the patients, that's why we tend to put the graft close to the renal arteries. We don't put any, because the long neck is there, we don't try to put it just below the aneurysm. So we try to go as high as possible to avoid this complication of dilatation of the neck. Neck dilatation, the infrarenal neck dilatation. So there is a risk of dilatation if you try to anastomosis far distally. So we go as high as possible. And sometimes patients do develop distal anastomotic aneurysms. In the olden days, they were using silk for suturing these vessels, not the proline. So those days, silk-induced reaction was there, and then patients were developing aneurysms at the anastomosis. So I happened to work in PGH Chandigarh. We were seeing after 10 years or 15 years of follow-up, patients were coming back with pseudo-aneurysms at the anastomosis. So those are the known problems. Sometimes stents, the grafts get thrombosed. And then we have to do thrombectomy of the graft, or sometimes we have to do crossover graft over the thrombosis. Sometimes they get thrombosed and they remain asymptomatic. Patients do remain asymptomatic. And sometimes the patients develop proximal aneurysms, suprarenal aneurysms will be appearing after 5 years or 10 years of time. So sometimes they develop even bowel ischemia if the supramesenteric artery is involved in the process.
Keeping all these things in view, what is your follow-up protocol? You ask them to get every year CT angio or MRI?
Yeah, this is also a very pertinent question in relevance to the current practice. Because endo repair, we always ask for examination at regular intervals. Ultrasound, I think more practical is an ultrasound examination. And for endo repairs, you are talking about endo tension. But whereas here we ask for the anastomotic junctions and also the vascular supply to the vital organs. So ultrasound examination by a good ultrasonologist is very helpful rather than asking CT scanning very frequently, because the number of CTs people are doing nowadays will produce cancer by itself. So we are cautious about the CT. If the ultrasound or Doppler scanning shows some evidence of involvement of these pseudo aneurysms or anything like that, then we ask for a CT scanning on a patient by patient basis rather than uniformly CT scanning in all patients at a once in a year. So duplex scan, non-invasive duplex in scanning is much better and safer in our view. And we generally make it convenient for the patient also by asking duplex scanning, by asking specific questions to the ultrasonologist, what we want to see in the patient.
What is the rate of re-intervention in these patients?
Yes, it is obvious that early re-interventions are less common compared to the endovascular procedures. But it can be as high as 10 to 15% based upon the level of anastomosis that you have done and the associated comorbidities and the distal disease that the patients have, like femoropopliteal disease or tibial vessel disease. The patients may have rethrombosis or thrombotic complications following repair in the next 5 to 10 years of time.
Correctly pointed, Dr. Ramakrishna, one CT scan is equal to radiation of 100 chest x-rays. Okay, present COVID era, what we are saying, they are using CT scan for diagnosis purposes.
Yes, not even diagnosis, for excluding.
Excluding also.
For excluding.
Yes, so before doing an angio and doing this one, so I'm really...
The sad story I heard is they are doing it on the attendants also.
Oh God, yeah. Because the problem is that they're thinking that attendant may be quarantine or not, whether to isolate or not.
Right.
My friend's father, I told him not to do, but somebody prevailed and they got the CT scan.
CT scanning is now with the flip of a coin, they are doing CT scan.
This one. So I think you correctly pointed out, they have to really worry about CT scan induced cancers rather than anything else in the future.
Yeah, it is written in the textbook also. So don't ask CT for a routine evaluation of the post-operative aneurysms. But if it is necessary, we should do it. If it is necessary, we should do it. So, Dr. Fayaz, would you like to ask any question? Because we asked you questions, now it is your turn to ask any question that you'd like to ask. Thank you for presenting nicely.
It was a nice presentation, Fayaz. Agreed.
In a very short notice, he has come with this presentation. Very short notice.
It was a nice presentation. And the surgical photos, operative photos were really good. Okay, and they very clearly explained the inverted Y grafting, okay, involving the common iliac on one side and the external iliac on the other side and all. I think all the points are being brought out very well, actually.
If anybody else would like to ask questions, I'll be happy to answer or Fayaz will answer.
Dr. Srinath is there, Dr. Jain is there.
Yeah, Dr. R.K. Jain.
Yeah.
He's an aneurysm specialist.
Both the states rather.
I think so, yes.
Okay. If there are no more questions, then probably we'll
go. Yeah, I'll start my presentation.
Okay. Yeah, and then Dr. Pinjal Ramakrishna is going to present his talk on evaluation of peripheral vascular disease.
Thank you. I'm going to open my PowerPoint presentation. Just a second.